Okay, welcome back, everyone. At this time, I'd like to call upon George Doyle to the podium, who will introduce our Willis Smith. Willis Smith, Jr., Professionalism Speaker, Superior Court Judge Carl Fox. Judge Fox has graciously donated the funds of the Willis Smith, Jr. Professionalism Endowment to the North Carolina Bar Foundation Annual Fund. Mr. Doyle.
Good morning. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Judge. Good morning. My name's George Doyle. I'm a lawyer in Orange County. My friends, this is not going to be a jury argument. My friends, this is a story. You're always supposed to tell the story. This is a story about professionalism and courage. I can't tell you what an honor it is to appear in front of you and introduce and tell you about my friend Carl Fox. I commend his biography to you. I would pay particular attention to the fact that he's the child of two school teachers from Mount Olive, North Carolina. You can tell by knowing him that they infused him with those important values that we value as lawyers: respect for others, respect for our peers, hard work, which in Carl devolved into a professional career. As I started, he was the assistant district attorney in Orange County. We just moved to the new courthouse on Franklin Street. He was there until 2005. Judge Barber retired, and the chatter amongst the local bar was, well, who's going to take Judge Barber's place? And I will tell you, the name Carl Fox, at least in my little circle, did not pop up. Despite his vast experience in criminal court, I think some of my civil friends wondered how would he be in civil court, although most of our Superior Court judges seem to be former DAs, and they seem to do pretty well. So word came that Carl actually was interested in the seat, and he was appointed to succeed Judge Barber in 2006. The first time I saw Carl as a judge is I happened to be in civil court. I do mostly criminal law. He was in the old courthouse in Hillsboro, where, as you know, they still have the little place where they shackled the defendants while they were waiting their fate. And I'm listening to one of you civil lawyers make some of those arcane arguments about uninsured motorist coverage. Or is it underinsured? In any case. And very nice looking men and women, well dressed in that old courthouse. And I see Carl do what he does. He sort of puts his hand on his face and he says, why should I do that? It woke up this courtroom. Even the bailiff woke up. I know Carl in criminal court. You know, in criminal court, if your client is going to get an active sentence, and the so-called plea colloquy is about over, I notice that the deputies start getting closer to me. Actually, it's to my client. And what does Judge Fox do at that moment? He turns to this defendant who's going into the prison system and says, give your mother a hug. Give your child a hug. That is the respect that he shows for even the least among us. It shows that that person means something when the man in the robe says, give your mother a hug. And it also tells that young person, you do have something to come back to. Not many judges do that. So just based on this record, I would stand before you and tell you that we are blessed to have Carl Fox as a Superior Court judge, and that I wish he could come into your district, although Wake has had him for about 50 years, and we in Orange are damn tired of that. So out of the blue, as life is, something happened to Carl. He contracted that blood cancer. I can't even say the name. He lost weight. The campaign Save the Fox began. You may have seen pictures of the football team and the basketball team donating DNA for testing. His wife, soon-to-be wife Julia, was with him every moment through this crisis. And I think he was told he had 3 months to live. Now, I've thought, if that happened to me, what would I do? I think I would just kind of stay home. Maybe mow the lawn the last couple times, maybe. But just not engage and just suffer the fate that God has given me. And maybe suffer in silence. Well, that's not what Carl Fox does. He attacked this disease with grace and cheer. He looked bad. He spoke to our bar meeting through this thing called, I don't know if you've heard of it, it's called Skype, where you can see people live. And it was that talk that he gave to us at our bar Christmas party that inspired me to learn from him, to learn what it means to be very successful and then to be knocked down. Throughout his career as an assistant district attorney and as a district attorney and as a judge, he has embodied what we hope professionalism means, what Mel Wright tried to do as the first person to run that office, the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism. When you see him in court, that is the role model you want to point those young lawyers to. Just remember, though, he may look at you and in a loud voice say, "Why should I do that?" Friends, please welcome my friend Carl Fox.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. It's a pleasure. I have to check my watch because I do that in court. I want to say good morning when it's afternoon. It's a pleasure to be. It's actually an honor to be selected to be here and speak to you this morning. I, what George didn't tell you about that Skype, I was defending my title for the best Christmas tie, and that had to be defended. So even Skype was necessary to do that. It's, I'm sitting there in that chair, and I'd just flown from Memphis back to RDU last week, and I was thinking to myself sitting in that chair, does this chair make my butt look big? Something about these chairs that feels like you're sitting right in the middle of that third chair in a row of five chairs on an airliner, and there's just not enough room for you. It's a real pleasure to be with you this morning. I was thinking back on what George was talking about, and it reminded me of probably what was the most difficult time of my life. Before I start this, I have to just give you some background. When I was thinking about what I wanted to talk with you about, I decided in sickness and health, because that's a vow from most people's wedding vows. And it means literally that something that you intend to do for the rest of your life. And being a lawyer is what most of us in this room have intended to do for the rest of our lives. Now, I thought about I call that the in sickness and in health clause. I thought about the for richer, for poorer clause, but that seemed to not go very well with professionalism. In order to give you an idea where I'm coming from on this, I have to tell you, 2014 and 2015 were the worst years of my 64 years on this earth. I started out in October 2014 with a limp, and most of you have never seen Gunsmoke. That was a show my father loved, and so I was forced to watch it with him, and there were these characters, Matt Dillon and Chester, his sidekick. And I started out with a limp in October that I couldn't understand where it came from. It just sort of jumped on me. And I started limping, and to try to counteract the limp, I counter-limped. And when you counter-limp, it makes you look like this. And I said, what is making me walk like this? And I couldn't figure it out. My wife noticed it, her father noticed it, and I just played it off. Well, by December, I was losing weight like I was on a combination of the Weight Watchers, the Atkins, and all the other diets out there. And I attributed it to my good diet and exercise regimen. In February 2015, the first sign of disaster struck. I was playing golf at Finley Golf Course on the warmest day in February, and I got off my cart to turn in my little sticker to the starter so I could tee off, and the cart started rolling, and I started chasing it. When it didn't stop, it jumped the curb and ran into the deepest part of the pond, and I thought it would stop, and it continued out into the middle of the pond. In the words of Charles Shackelford, it became amphibious, went right out to the deepest part of the pond. This course is full of people. Then it slowly sinks, and to add insult to injury, the seat comes up and turns as if to take a bow, and then my golf clubs come up and take a bow, and I just thought, does it get any worse than this? Yes, it could. In April, I was in court in Charlotte, and I just worked out at Gold's Gym before court. When I came back to take a shower, I looked down at my right leg, and there was a bump on it. I thought it was a blood clot, and I was real concerned at first. And then I said, well, I don't know where I get it checked right now. Wait till I get home. Turned out it wasn't a blood clot, it was a hematoma. But how it happened, I didn't know. Well, later I kept getting it checked, in front of my doctor, did some blood work and figured out I had a lack of platelets. And for those of you who don't know, platelets don't just clot when you get cut. They keep every organ in your body from leaking blood. And my count, which should normally be 150 at a minimum, was 8,000. So I had to cancel court and go into the hospital at that time. And I got referred to the benign oncology clinic. And I'll share more on that benign later. And I went to a couple of appointments, and then the doctor sat down with me in that way that only happens in the parlor of a funeral home, and says, I decided to refer you to the oncology hematology clinic. Those words will cause fear in even the fiercest person's heart. I guarantee you that. And when I went there, they did some testing, found out I had a disease called myelodysplastic syndrome, which is when the blood cells start producing, but they don't mature. I wasn't producing platelets. So I had to go into the hospital and get infusions of platelets twice a week. And then, because they run out, unlike red blood cells, after a short period of time, then stopped producing red blood cells and white blood cells. So I had no defense mechanism, no immune system, and I had no red blood cells. So I had to get shots of infusions of blood, and then my immune system consisted of a handful of pills. And so I started getting these infusions, and they started giving me azacitidine on an outpatient basis, and that didn't end up working. So they said the only hope is a transplant, and you have 3 months to live. I can tell you that will change your life, having someone tell you that. And so I started getting my affairs in order, but I can tell you, at night when I was alone, I cried. I cried. I thought, why me? Why did this happen to me? What did I do? And there was no match on the horizon. I thought the match system worked so that it checked constantly. It doesn't. They check it once a month because it's too expensive. And so I tried to figure out what to do. So a group of us got together and formed this. Alan Bedour is one of those people. And my wife Julia was one of those people. And we formed Save the Fox. And Save the Fox was to try to raise awareness about blood cancer and try to increase the donor registry so that even if I didn't find a match, somebody else would find one, because there are 15,000 people waiting. And we signed up between 4,000 and 5,000 people through that effort. And we had lawyers like Bob Zellinger, who had kits in his office. We had a volunteer named Leslie Morrow, who did every one of those registration things. And we signed up a ton of people. And to date, we've saved 14 other people. Didn't save me, but saved 14 other people's lives through that effort out of those 4,000 people. And I'm a sort of religious person. I don't wear it on my sleeve, but I thought to myself, well, you know, I think God was trying to tell me this. Miraculously, in August, I got a call from my doctor. They'd found an umbilical cord match, and it was a 4 out of 6, and that's the least they do. And UNC Hospitals doesn't do a lot of that kind of transplant, but they did in my case, and it actually worked better than a lot of the other people I know who've had real 10 out of 10 donor matches. But it wasn't an easy process. I had to go into the hospital in September, and they they give you 7 days of chemo. Then they take you in the last day, because they're trying to kill off your what remains of anything in your bone marrow. And they sit you on this table. And if you've ever been concerned about radiation in your dentist's office or an x-ray, don't. Because they shot me with the radiation for 10 minutes on one side, turned me over like a burger, and shot me with 10 minutes more on the other side. I have never been so weak in my life. And then they drip these cells into my body, and miraculously, those cells know where to go. They went right to my bone marrow and started producing cells gradually. But that wasn't the end of it. For 30 days, I was in the dark. I was like I was in a well. And like, if you've seen the movie The Ring, you get some idea what I'm talking about. I felt like I was in this dark well, and I couldn't get out. I didn't eat for almost 2 weeks. And so I lost down to 130 pounds. I mean, I'll show you. I'm just giving you a prelude to this. And I heard this voice, and it was my now wife, and she said, I just want to know, are you going to try to live, or are you going to die? And at this point, they had asked her if she wanted to minister, and she said, well, what, to pray for him? And she said, no, to give him last rites. And I thought to myself, I'd been given this chance. If I wasn't going to use it, I should let somebody else have it. And I decided I wanted to live. And she had them put a feeding tube in. And from that time, between those boosts and all those kind of things, I made it back to look sort of like the guy that wins the marathon in Boston every year. You know how I'm talking about how thin that guy is? I mean, I was discharged on November 4th, and someone took a photograph of me and Julia, and I said, I know I recognize you, but who's the Kenyan marathon runner behind you? But then you have to be on, I had to be on about 90 days of house arrest. Let me just tell you judges out there, you think house arrest is a slap on the wrist? Try staying in your house for 90 days. I can tell you, that's not funny. And everybody brings you chicken soup. Everybody, let me tell you, chicken soup doesn't cure squat. I mean, just so you know it. It doesn't cure anything. I used to love chicken noodle soup. Now, if you bring soup near me, I'm just like, no soup, no chicken soup, please. And people would want you to eat it, and you'd sit there and go like, I'm real full right now. Hard to look full when you weigh 130 pounds, but that was the story I gave. I had to relearn how to drive and do all those things, and so it was tough. And now I'm going to go to this presentation here because I needed to do that. If you studied business at all in school, you probably took organizational behaviors. And if you took organizational behaviors, you had to know this little diagram. And it's interesting, and I present it to you because I think that's the way most professionals think. But I'm going to tell you from my perspective, here's what's wrong with this diagram. The things that matter most are at the bottom, middle to the bottom of this chart. And it would do you no good to be the most esteemed, accomplished person and have the respect of your colleagues and lose the support and love of your family. And so I don't necessarily agree with this chart. Let me go further. I think most of you, if I said, what matters to you? The list would probably be somewhere along this line. Maybe not, but I don't think it's too far off. I'm not going to ask you to see if you agree with me or not, because you have families, and that would be terrible if you said, oh, your family's way down there, but this other stuff is way up there. But, you know, I put this to you this way and just say, well, what if it changed? If something changed and that order changed, how would that change your life for the good or the bad? Do you know that while I was on the GAA board at UNC, I got a report that said in the Career Planning and Placement Office, 50% of the people looking to change careers were lawyers. 50%. I was looking at statistics on the internet, and they say that after 5 years, a lot of lawyers are looking to change careers. And I think there's some, either people don't have a good idea of what they're getting into when they go into law, or they're just seriously disappointed when they're in this. I was speaking to a retired judge the other day, and I said, have you ever thought about going back to work with a firm? He said, hell no. I mean, why not? He goes, I don't want to get back in that billable hours thing and working 50 and 60 hours a week. Okay, well, I get that. But think about how those things would change if, and change you as a professional, if that was the way you looked at life. So all of us have career expectations. All of us have things that we want to accomplish while we work or doing what we do. The problem is there are unexpected changes that can change all of that in an instant. You could get fired, or you could get, they could down, your firm could downsize, or you could lose an election. You could just suddenly get disappointed with your job, don't like the work environment. You could get stymied, or you could have a health crisis. And the health crisis is probably the most unexpected of those career changes. Now, I didn't list on here sudden accidental problems, because there's no way of anticipating sudden accidental problems, and those do occur. But those are the things that are most likely to be the unexpected changes. So what can they do? Well, they can change your income. They can leave you with no income. You can have to start all over again. You can have hardship and bankruptcy. Do you know that one of the leading causes, if not the leading cause, of personal bankruptcy in this country is medical expenses? And if you think they're going to let you off the hook for those medical expenses, think again. I have signed more than one judgment to register an award or a verdict against someone, a judgment against someone, so that it goes another 10 years. And sometimes you're not even asked. When my brother was in the hospital, I had asked, does any of these forms obligate me for my brother's medical obligation? Because he's a grown man. He may qualify for Medicaid, and I'm not his support. And only then did the person pull that form that would have obligated me for his medical expenses, which would have easily exceeded $100,000. Think about that. And there are, when someone tells you your life expectancy is reduced, that is a sobering moment, I promise you. So these are the kind of things that you can't anticipate. I have known several police officers who've retired who developed some type of mental illness that they never exhibited prior to retirement. There's all kind of substance abuse we all know is a problem in the practice of law. You could have any number of physical disabilities. One of my friends, Craig Brown, who used to be a judge over in Durham, just suddenly went gradually blind for no apparent reason. And can you imagine what that would be like when you're used to seeing all the time? And disease or illness. I lost one of my good friends recently to ALS. And, you know, a lot of people are suffering from Parkinson and Alzheimer's. And these are difficult and trying illnesses, not only on the patient, but also on families. Well, see, this is what happened to me. So I just sort of outlined what I just told you about what indicated that I had a problem. And the people least likely to admit they have a problem are men. Men are least likely. We are all citizens of Egypt because we are completely in denial. And we will just go, oh, that limp, that's why I was walking like this for years. Oh, that unusual heartbeat I have, I mean, no biggie. It's so easy to turn your back on things that are clearly telling you something is wrong. So, you know, a lot of places you may have to go, if you have cancer, you may have to go to any number of medical centers around the world for treatment. And it isn't cheap. I mean, I got people recommending me to all kinds of places. It could affect your work because you're frequently going into treatment. Even afterwards, you might go in for consults and for examination 3 times a week. And let me tell you, if they do a bone marrow biopsy on you, that's gonna hurt for days. It can affect all kinds of things. And the last thing, and one of the big things is medical costs. But when you're really sick, you're really not caring about medical costs too much. Bad things happen to good people. You know, one of the most sobering things that for me was when I was going to the hospital one day and somebody wheeled by a little kid, 2 years old, who was wearing a cap, who had lost all her hair because she had cancer. And I saw kids who were 1, 2, and 3 years old, and all I could think, okay, I'm 60-something, I get this, but why them? Why these kids? It's heartbreaking. And you have to realize that you're not the only one. How many of you have been affected by cancer in this room? Okay. How about addiction in this room? Known anybody who was addicted to anything? Sure. I mean, had anyone who's had family members or friends with ALS or Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, or any of those things? Of course. The odds are that somebody in this room is going to be affected by all of this. I mean, we have our own judges who are battling with illnesses. Ola Lewis was here, and she turned right around and went back to Rochester for more treatment. Judge Christian just came back on the bench just recently. Nick Dombalis and John Stewart, my friends, are still, Don has gone through his second transplant, and Nick is hoping for good things out of his experimental treatment. You know, but good things also happen to good people. But sometimes it gets worse. And sometimes things that you could never imagine happen and it looks really bleak. That's how bleak it can get. That is me at 130 pounds. When I wondered why people thought I was gonna die, my wife showed me that photograph and I thought, wow, I'd have thought I was gonna die too. I mean, a guy who was used to wear a 46 coat down to a 36 coat. I told this repeatedly. I mean, I told it every chance I got. And then when I got cancer, I went, I shouldn't have told that nearly as much as I did. I shouldn't have. And, but you know, just like in that vignette, you experience a lot of things when you get really, really, really sick. And truthfully, there are a lot of people working in our practices who suffer some of these same kinds of things, and in their work who suffer these same fear, doubt, loneliness. I mean, one of the best things we have is in the state system is the ability to share leave for people who are sick, and you wouldn't believe the number of people on a weekly basis who need that leave. What's an appropriate reaction? A second opinion? Of course it is. I mean, I'd want one before I had somebody chop my leg off. And, you know, your treatment options. And the other is, if necessary, getting your affairs in order. And I started doing that. And I'll tell you, that is as tough as things get to start parceling out your stuff and figuring out how you're going to settle everything before you die. Because we don't tend to think in those terms. But I also looked for scapegoats. I also looked for things to blame. Sometimes I focused on what was not working. But I didn't pass up opportunity for possibility when I had the opportunity to get a transplant, I took that chance. And I wouldn't be here today if I hadn't. Or you can just resign to your fate. And that's probably the easiest way out, but it's not necessarily the best way out. Just like practicing law, you need the kind of things like courage, confidence, support, optimism, and in serious illness, you need surviving role models. A dead role model is not very helpful, I can tell you that. You need to be able to look at someone and say, they made it, I can make it. And I looked at my sister, who is a 20-year cancer survivor, and Robin Roberts, who had breast cancer and contracted the same disease I have, MDS, from her as a result of her chemotherapy, and said, if they can do it, I can do it. Sometimes, just like at work, you have to try to make it another day. Work is tough, you know? I can tell you this. I hope in the other place, in heaven or wherever you think of the afterlife as being, there aren't jobs. I really do. I hope there isn't employment. I have to go out and apply for a job or go back to school and do that kind of stuff. I want a heaven that gets you relaxation, you know? Hell would be going, you got to apply back to law school. That bar exam has gotten even tougher than when you took it the first time. And you're not going to be able to find a job even when you pass it. You just got to believe, like when you were in school and in life, that you can really, that you can make it, and you got to do what you have to do regardless of how you feel about it. I decided to fight a public fight. And you know why I did that is because when you're a public official, if you don't make it public, someone else will set out a rumor. And it's harder to put down a rumor than it is to tell what the real situation is. And I'd had that happen earlier, so I decided I would wage a public fight. And the funny thing was, people would come up to me who were sick and say, I hear you have cancer. I had cancer too, and I'm thinking, do I have a collar on? Am I a cleric now? What? I mean, people are now telling me about their, but on the other hand, it says that they have some respect for you and what you're going to, and they sympathize and empathize with where you are. And that kind of support, in my mind, overrode my desire not to let people know and to keep it a secret. I couldn't have gotten all those people on the registry if I hadn't done what I did. And out of this, you can find a sense of purpose. You know, that's so important in work, to find a sense of purpose. You know, I say this in all truth, the difference between a good lawyer and a great lawyer in this judge's mind is humility. A great lawyer, you would never know a great lawyer was a great lawyer unless someone else told you. A lawyer who's a good lawyer, who's got no humility, will trot to that horn themselves. And in the end, it isn't really what we think of ourselves, and it's not really whether we're good lawyers. If we want to be remembered, it's all about what other people think of us as good people and as a person. And that's the way I hope all of us want to be remembered. I just tried to think about what I wanted to do and how I wanted to leave life. And none of that has changed. That it's all about trying to help other people. And someone said to me, I changed this, it's not the quantity of your life, but the quality of your life that matters. Most stuff in our lives is small stuff when we really think about it. Very little is important, and it's the important stuff that we should be concerned about, but small stuff we shouldn't sweat. We should just do stuff because we can. We're lawyers. We have the ability to make change. One of the biggest reasons people go to law school is because they want to make a difference, and we should make that possible that they can be that difference, and that's one of the good things about the pro bono program. But you should also take care of yourselves. I hear lawyers say, I don't have time. I wish I could do that. I don't have time to do that. You could if it's important to you. If you made it important to you, you could get it done. taking care of yourself is important because you can't take care of someone else's business and their affairs if you are not up to that and you're not taking care of yourself. Spend time with those folks who love you. I mean, that is so important. And you lose, if you love someone, you lose them, you hurt. And there's a reason for that, because they're close to, if you lose a case, it feels bad, but you don't hurt when you lose a case. If you think it's important to pay attention to yourself and try to do your bucket list while you still have time to, don't plan on doing it in retirement. Life is uncertain. Death, unfortunately, is not. And in my life now, every day is a gift, and I assume nothing when I wake up. If it ain't broke, it ain't broke, don't fix it, doesn't apply to your health, I assure you. And no one has ever said from their bed, deathbed, I wish I'd worked a little harder or a little bit more. That's just not something you say. I think that civility, whether it's in the practice of law or just in life, is so important. It takes so little to say hello. It takes so little to say nice job. It takes so little to say thank you. And by the way, I want to thank John Martin over there, because without John, those videos that you saw and some of the stuff couldn't be on there, because Carl doesn't do computer very well. Do you want to be remembered as a good lawyer or a good person? Your friends in this room and around your community will remember you as a good lawyer if you're their lawyers. But other people won't if you're not a good person, because that's what lasts. I used to think, I didn't understand the words for a long time, if it isn't, what doesn't kill you make you strong, makes you stronger. I now know. When you come close to death and you're at death's door, if it doesn't kill you, you'll never be the same. And we all have the ability to make a difference. If you're not a donor, you're not on the registry to donate, to try to save someone else's life, if you're not on that registry where you're a donor so that you can give, organs and organs, an organ donor, that kind of thing, please consider it. I mean, what we do on paper and in court, some of that really matters, and a lot of that really matters, but there is nothing like saving the life of another human being. Nothing like it, I promise you. And if you do it, and it happens, you will be eternally grateful for it. It's my pleasure to be here. Without my wife, I wouldn't. Without one of my professors, Paul Brandis, and one of my biology teachers, Brenda Lancaster, I never thought about going into law. And without my sister, I probably wouldn't have believed I could have pulled this off. And I want to thank you for allowing me to be with you today, because in 2015, I wouldn't have given a nickel to think I would be able to be here today. It's been my honor and a privilege to be here with you. I think so much of each and every one of you, those I know and those I don't know, and I hope that the rest of your lives won't include anything I've talked about my life. Best wishes, thank you.